Closed captioning provided by the University of Tennessee Full-Time MBA Program. Transforming lives, careers, your future. It all starts here. That knows no equal. The most celebrated of traditions. The heart and soul of the Volunteer State. This is Tennessee. For the next 60 minutes, you're tuned to Vol Network coverage of the Tennessee Volunteers. Inside Tennessee Football is brought to you by First Tennessee, home to Big Orange Banking. First Tennessee, the official bank of the Vols. By Farm Bureau Insurance, with agents in more communities than any other insurer. Tennessee turns to Farm Bureau Insurance. By your local Ford dealer, fans of Tennessee football and trucks. Visit shopfordnow.com and check out the built Ford Tough F-150. And by Verizon, official wireless provider of the Tennessee Volunteers.
Hi, everyone. I'm Bob Kesling of the Vol Network, and welcome to Inside Tennessee Football. Tennessee Volunteers had Senior Day on Saturday at Neyland Stadium. The season finale in the Volunteers in a rousing finish against Kentucky beat the Wildcats 37-17. Tyler Bray had a big day, four touchdown passes, and the defense made some big stops against the Cats in the second half to preserve this victory for the Volunteers. We'll show you highlights from the game. We'll hear comments from Tennessee coach Jim Chaney, and also we'll look ahead to next year and salute the 13 seniors on this Tennessee team. All of that and more next here on Inside Tennessee Football.
It's time to recognize our Donate Life Tennessee Vol Scholar of the Week. This week, we recognize Dallas Thomas's achievements in the classroom. The senior offensive lineman from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, is a sociology major and is scheduled to graduate next month. Dallas is known as a hard worker in the classroom and on the playing field as well. He's donated his time to Habitat for Humanity and is a volunteer reader for the Knox County School System. Dallas Thomas, a great volunteer. Become a volunteer for life and sign the Donate Life Tennessee Registry online at DonateLifeTN.org. Sign up, save lives.
Tennessee wins the season finale against the Kentucky Wildcats 37-17. We're joined now by Tennessee interim head coach and offensive coordinator Jim Chaney. Coach, congratulations on a big win.
Thank you. It was a lot of fun out there today.
All right, talk about everything that happened during the week getting this team ready to play this football game.
It was an interesting one. It was tough in the beginning of the week. They were a little down, but they came around. The seniors stepped up and then put their point across to the rest of the team. We need to go out and play a good ball game and win, and they did.
Did you change the routine at all, or is it trying to keep it as normal as
no,
possible?
No, we kept it as normal as possible. Coach Dooley's done a great job of getting everything set in the way, and the kids are routine-driven, and we're ready to go play.
Suddenly, you had to put a different hat on, though. You're the head guy, and also now it's senior day, and you've got to greet those 13 seniors.
Someone mentioned to me earlier, congratulations on the victory. And I'll tell you, the most thrilling part was watching the seniors run out and seeing their faces. It was quite an experience, and I'm glad to be a part of it.
And there's Coach Chaney leading the Vols through the tee on a special day, a senior day, and now we go to work. Tennessee took the ball first, won the toss, and you went right at Kentucky.
You bet. This is a good throw to Justin Hunter on the crook route, we call it, and he made a big play for us.
Went to work with Marlon Lane then up the middle.
You bet. As soon as we can get Marlon involved with the game, the better off we can. He runs the ball physical there.
This is Rajon Neal again, so you found some room to run the ball against Kentucky.
Yeah, they were giving us a coverage that we wanted to try to attack in the middle with the runs, and it worked out good.
And then Tyler Bray goes to another senior. That's Zach Rogers.
You got to love it. I mean, it couldn't have been a more fitting way to get your first touchdown as Tyler throwing the ball to a senior. It was awesome.
Talk about the route that Zach run to get open. He has a tendency to outrun those safeties that they get on him.
Oh, he does. We call it a little stop route. He pushes outside, and it's a vertical route if the field's open with no safeties in the middle. And he's ran it 1,000 times, and he ran it very well right there.
So Tyler Bray with the touchdown strike on the opening drive. Tennessee leads 7-0, but, Coach, here comes Kentucky right back.
Oh, they did. We made a wonderful play there. We got him behind the stake several times, and Jordan showed up for us many times, as did Jock. The D-line came to play today.
Whitlow, the quarterback, back to throw down the sideline.
Yeah, they hit us with a little wheel route. We hadn't seen that out of them yet, and they picked us in the coverage and did a nice job on it.
So now Whitlow throws to DJ Warren. An Alcoa native gets the touchdown, and now it's 7-7, and Kentucky goes for an onside kick.
Yeah, I thought Jacob was going to take this to the house. We were yelling at him to go. We knew they'd been trying this all year, and they were prepared.
So Jacob Carter fields the onside, puts Tennessee in great field position.
We're trying to throw a touchdown pass here, and the defensive back did a nice job of carrying Justin, and then CP did what CP does. I have no idea where he's going, but he's moving the ball down the field, so we're happy with it.
Got 16 yards on that one from side to side. But a good run by Patterson. Now Tyler Bray to Vincent Dallas.
You bet. Vincent showed up all year for us. I'm real proud of him. He's played good, disciplined football. He steps up and goes in there and makes plays. He wanted to score a touchdown. Couldn't quite get him.
But A.J. Johnson did.
Had to get the beast package up again, and it was simple. The line did a wonderful job, and the tight ends did, getting A.J. in the end zone.
All right, talk about this formation and why has it worked so well for Tennessee this year.
Well, it forces you to detach a defensive player out to cover the quarterback, which gives you a better mathematical advantage in the line of scrimmage. So it's easy math.
And it's also nice to have a big body like that to run the football.
Wonderful.
So now Tennessee gets the ball back, and Bray again.
Throwing it deep. We were always trying to get vertical on Kentucky. We thought that was a big part of our game plan going in and throwing it down the field.
This is a brilliant pass from Bray to Hunter. However, this one was called back, but still a great throw and great catch.
Oh, it was wonderful. Once again, we said the same thing. If we can get behind them, let's take our shots. They got Antonio here for a hold. You know, I'm not sure. I didn't see it. Yeah. So he said he didn't do it like they all did.
So now we go to the second quarter, and Bray to Hunter. Oh, another great throw.
Another play we thought we had. We didn't think their safeties got off the hash the way we wanted them to, and Justin was in the right spot. So nice execution.
So Tennessee sends Justin Hunter in between the cornerback and the safety.
Yes, that's the whole goal, hitting that honey hole, we call it.
The honey hole. And Bray was right on target with Hunter, and Hunter again ran a good route and caught the ball.
Yes, he did. He's done a nice job of that all year long right here. You can see him choke. We're trying to hit it about 18 yards, 2 yards from the sideline, and that's right where he caught it. It was a nice executed play.
So Tyler Bray, the touchdown catch. Tennessee missed the extra point, however, so now it's 20-7.
I thought we defended this play extremely well throughout the day. The cornerbacks and the safeties did a nice job on their little bubble screens.
But then Kentucky, on this play, able to find a little seam, and Jonathan George.
Yeah, a little different wrinkle. They haven't shown it much. Threw the quick trap at us away from our loaded front, and they split us and made a play.
So a 45-yard touchdown run for Kentucky. Made it 20-14. Now Kentucky trying to take the lead.
You step right back up, and A.J. made a big play for us, and that's what he's been doing all fall.
So Kentucky settles at that point for a field goal. Now Kentucky, this is playing the third quarter.
You bet. They got us on a little quick out here to convert and move the chains down to the 10-yard line. We have to step up big here. It's a tough one now, but the kids came through, and Jordan made a big play for us on the sack on a negative yardage play. It was good.
So Kentucky had a chance to take the lead, but again, Jordan Williams with this great defensive. And you said his motor runs all the time.
All the time. High motor kid. You put a running back on him, we're going to win that most of the time. I thought the defense did a real nice job there, and Sal made some nice calls, just slowing him down there to hold him to a field goal.
So that makes it 20-17, Tennessee.
We come back throwing the ball down the field. We're going to go vertical with the passing game. We stayed with that, and the kids kept executing.
That was Carter on the catch.
This is the play we used against South Carolina a few weeks ago and hit Michael running down the sideline. Once again, he's a senior, and he had a wonderful season for us. Real pleased. When Justin Hunter makes the play by running the post and dragging the safety and corner out of the play, and Tyler made a nice read and delivered the ball accurately.
Makes it 27-17.
Here we go again with giving the ball to this crazy kid. I don't know where he's going to roll, but he moved around, made some nice plays for us. This was an audible at the line of scrimmage. Worked out good. Same thing. We've been diving in there on our little play-action pass, so we thought we had this. We held this till we needed it, and it was a nice play by the kids. They executed it very well. CP and Tyler, and once again, the offensive line gave them all the time in the world again. But this is a wonderful route by CP. You know, well executed. They've run that play a lot, and they did a nice job.
You've been waiting for Patterson to run routes like that, aren't you?
Oh, certainly. And he shows up every once in a while, does a wonderful job.
So now Tennessee trying to run the clock out in the fourth quarter, and Marlon Lane, good second effort.
I don't know that I've ever seen a run quite like this. He was cutting back, went back front way, went back the other way, had a little hamstring strain midway down this run. The play took 20 seconds off the clock. It was amazing.
And then Michael Pilardi comes on and nails the field goal.
You bet. He got three more points on the board for us. I was happy for Michael to go out there and step up and make a play.
You get a Gatorade shower from the guys. Tyler Bray was leading that, and the seniors got the run off the field with a victory. That would be very special.
Oh, it was an incredible experience, one that I hope I would never have to do again with such a good friend like Derek. But I was happy that the seniors got to leave victorious, and it was a lot of fun.
you had to be proud of how this team came together and the coaching staff came together, because this was a tough week.
Well, we have an older, mature staff. Everybody understands the reality of our profession, and they went to work every day, and we did what we needed to do to keep the kids focused, to play their last game, and they went out and executed enough to find us a way to win the ball game.
Tennessee beats Kentucky 37-17. Back to take a look at those seniors next on Inside Tennessee Football.
Fans, your child's inside look at Tennessee athletics is available through the Junior Vols Club. Annual memberships include a Junior Vols t-shirt, monthly newsletters, free admission to select UT sporting events, and much more. For more information or to sign up for Junior Vols, visit utsports.com. Presented by the Knoxville Orthopedic Clinic, proudly serving the University of Tennessee Athletic Department since 1949. It's time now for Ask the Coach, presented by Academy Sports and Outdoors. Currently serving Vol fans with 6 Tennessee locations and online 24/7 at academy.com.
Chaney, this first one's from Byron Ayers. He wants to know, how was it to be the head coach your first game today at Tennessee?
It was eventful, to say the least. It was a learning experience. You have so much anxiety thinking that you're going to mess something up and mess up the game for these young men. And that's my biggest paranoia. Fortunately, today we didn't have a lot of tough decisions that I had to make, and the kids went out and played well and did it. But it was a wonderful time, wonderful experience, and the kids were great, and I enjoyed it very much.
Were you ever a head coach at any level, any place before?
I have been before. In 1985, I coached the Anaheim Police Department versus the Placentia Fire Department in Orange County. Now, it could have been the Anaheim Fire Department, Brea, one of those two.
But so now you're 2-0 as a head coach.
I don't remember if I won or lost.
Say you're 2-0.
Yeah, we were 2-0.
Absolutely.
We killed them.
What was your role now? As the next question from Mark Cook, your role now as interim head coach of the Volunteers. Now the season is over, what do you do starting Sunday morning?
Well, I just want to be there for the players and make sure they're going to class. I know Coach Dooley is paramount to him that those kids go to class and do the right thing, and I want to continue on with that legacy to make sure that the boys finish this semester very well and do a good job, and they're right on top of their grades right now. We want to make sure they do that. So I'm going to be there for them all the way through. We have some juniors that are going to have some tough decisions, so I'll be there in the middle of those conversations also, just to help and guide them through in conjunction with Mr. Hart, just to see which direction they're going to go.
You know, a bunch of those seniors on the feature, like Bartholomew and Prentice Wagner and Michael Rebecca, they've all got their degrees, and that's something special, too.
Oh, I tell you, like I said earlier, that watching those kids run through the tee was the highlight of the day. It's really a special occasion, and it's a great tradition that Tennessee has, and it was really special for me personally to be a part of it.
Coach, congratulations on the win, and thanks for giving your heart and soul to Tennessee.
Well, it's very kind of you to say, and I wouldn't change a thing. And the last 4 years have been a wonderful experience. Thanks, Bob.
Jim Chaney, Tennessee's interim head coach, and he coached the Volunteers to the win over Kentucky 37-17. We'll continue on Inside Tennessee Football in just a moment.
Time out to check the stats. Brought to you by Dick.
Great quarterbacks playing at the University of Tennessee are nothing new for the Big Orange. Touchdowns have been heaved from the likes of Manning, Holloway, Ainge, Robinson, Kelly, Clausen, Martin, and current QB, Tyler Bray. With all the greats to play the position, it is Bryson City, North Carolina's very own that poised at number one with the most consecutive games throwing a touchdown pass. Check the stats. Heath Shuler stands atop with 18 consecutive games with throwing a touchdown, from Alabama in 1992 to Shuler's final game against Penn State on January 1st, 1994.
Check the stats. Only from Dish do you get the hot whole home HD DVR. Learn more at dishvols.com. Catch the Vols on Dish, official sponsor of the Big Orange.
Time now for the Tennessee Top 5, brought to you by Hyundai. Loyalty can't be explained, but it explains a lot.
Eighth play of this opening drive, 12:59 to go in the first. Here's Bray over the middle, post pattern complete. Touchdown, Tennessee, Zach Rogers.
Yeah, well, we saw cover two, and they left the middle wide open. I just had a middle read, and Deeper hit me over the middle, and it was nice to get a touchdown on senior day.
Slot to the right, the wide side. Bray will hand fake, make it, fires for the end zone. Caught, checkerboards, touchdown for Darryl Patterson. Another brilliant play fake by Tyler Bray.
Tyler Bray, he had a good little sale. Fake the running back, he seen me wide open, and he just put it right on the money. Just get out there and just score and just hit the fans cheering for you. It's nice.
Kentucky at the Tennessee 14-yard line. Tennessee leads 20-14. Here's Wendell being sacked by A.J. Johnson back at the 25-yard line.
It opened up for me. I was green dogging to the back end. It opened up for a sack. It feels good to get my first sack. I've been waiting for one to come, and it came finally.
Bray fakes it. Now he fires for the end zone. Touchdown, Tennessee!
Funny thing, it was the same play that I ran against Georgia State, and it was the same play I ran against South Carolina. So we ran that play a couple times where I just fake like I'm blocking on the outside of the perimeter and just take it up the sideline.
Third down and two at the Kentucky 42-yard line. Tennessee leads 14-7. Bray gonna fire down the right sideline. Pass complete down to the 25-yard line. To the 10, to the 5, to the checkerboards. Justin Hunter.
Basically, it was a play designed for Zach. Just move the chains and Tyler seen the defense and just spreading out. And he threw a hole shot to me, and I had one man to beat. So I gave him a strong cut, 42.
Top five plays from Tennessee's win over Kentucky. I'm joined by my Vol Network teammates, Tim Priest, Andy Kelly. Thanks for coming on today, guys. Good win today for Tennessee, Tim.
Big win. You want to go in the offseason with something positive, and this, I think, gave the players, they've got a lot of uncertainty in their lives right now. This gives them something positive to look forward to.
You know, you look at things that are turning points in the game. I thought in the third quarter when Kentucky took the ball, marched down the field, ate up about half of the third quarter, but yet Tennessee held them to a field goal. I thought that was a big turning point in the game.
Big stop, and they kicked and made the field goal, but they didn't take the lead in the ball game that they would have done if they'd scored a touchdown. So big stop, and then the offense really got untracked.
Tyler Bray, Andy, today was really good, wasn't he?
He was. They had a few issues with protection, I think, in the second quarter, but early in the game, and then the entire second half, he had time. He was making great reads, and Coach Chaney dialed up some pretty special plays, and he was sharp in the second half.
Four touchdown passes for Bray today, and he is really razor sharp on all of his throws most of the day.
He was, and he spread it around to four different receivers, and when you can do that, and Tennessee ran the ball effectively most of the day, which set up some of the play action passes. So he had a really good day. The offense in general for most of the day was pretty sharp, putting points on the board, and Tyler Bray was really good, getting the ball to a lot of different guys.
You know, every time you talk about Bray having a big day, you also talk about the offensive line, but there was that double fake that Tennessee had run before, and then the touchdown throw to Rivera. And so Tennessee was very creative, I thought, offensively today.
They were. They dialed up a few plays. The play action play to Patterson at one point when he sucked the safety all the way up into the line of scrimmage and came open with the post. And then, as you mentioned, the double reverse fake hitting Rivera up the sideline. And then just Tyler Bray being on target and giving his big play receivers chances to make plays. The touchdown to Rogers down the middle of the field was well executed, and just an overall good, solid offensive performance.
And then when Tennessee got the lead, Tim, and took care of the football and took advantage of scoring opportunities, the defense in the second half played a lot better, didn't they?
They did. I think they had more sacks today than they've had all season. Jordan Williams sack. just the
AJ
whole
Johnson had a sack.
He did, and Jaquez Smith had a sack. So all the defensive front got more consistent pressure than they had been. And if you get a sack, almost always that will kill the drive.
Yeah, indeed. And there's another play by Jaquez Smith, and everybody got involved a little bit in the game. Now, this was not a great Kentucky offense. In fact, it was very bad Kentucky offense all season long. But Tennessee, other than the one run by George, Tennessee never really let Kentucky get much going offensively.
That was the only really big play. Randy Sanders, former Tennessee coach, running the offense at Kentucky, and I know he worked hard on how to try to attack this Tennessee defense, and he had some good ideas, some play-action passes and things that worked early, but Tennessee seemed to kind of get the idea of how Kentucky was trying to attack after that, did a really good job of shutting them down in the second half.
Andy, I thought field position was really important in the game, too. Tennessee's cover teams kept Kentucky backed up, and so when they got the ball, they had to go the long distance. That was a key, I thought.
It was. It gave you put your defense in good positions. Pilardi had a good day, maybe his best day that I can remember, punting the football. It made Kentucky go the long distance. When you have to do that time after time, you have to be really sharp on offense in order to score points. Luckily, they had the long way to go. Tennessee's defense was able to stop them most of the day.
You know, and this also brings a lot of momentum for Tennessee for the offseason. You hate to go into the offseason off a loss, don't you?
Well, and it's big. You know, I know the upperclassmen, the seniors, want to go out on a positive note with the win, but the underclassmen, they, you know, they look up to those seniors, they're friends with those guys, and I know you always want to send your senior class out with on a positive note with the win. So it means a lot to the underclassmen as well to send those guys off on a positive note. So it's a good thing that the Tennessee got the victory today, and they got to leave the field with a smile on their face.
Tim, you get to do the post-game interviews for the Vol Network in the locker room. Sometimes this season has been kind of tough, but today was good to see him smiling and also send these seniors out on a good note.
Yes, sir. And a lot of days I look up with a microphone in my hand and it's hard to get one guy there. Today they were coming in threes. Everybody wanted to talk today. And it's fun to win, and they've had some tough days. Four SEC football games came down to the last possession that they lost. Mm-hmm. That's tough and it wears on your psyche. So everybody was happy. It was a fun locker room, fun to talk to those guys, particularly the seniors that were going out feeling better about themselves.
And especially Ben Bartholomew. We had talked to Wednesday night on Vol Calls after his. I said, Bartholomew has never carried the football. Would you please just let him at least score a touchdown, or at least carry the ball once, and he did at the end.
Those are the first two plays I think I've ever known that you called because you talked him into running, Ben, and he got 7 yards on one and a first down on the second one.
Great average.
Well, we were saying, in fact, you got a 7 yard for carry average for your entire career, then he got that other first down, but that was more important to keep the sticks moving.
It was.
Ben's just, of course, his whole family is tremendous and all Tennessee through and through. But to see Ben have that success, and he's got his degree and all those type things. So that's kind of the role model you want for a Tennessee football player.
Quality young man is, I think, the segment that was run just a little bit earlier on the show showed all these seniors are intelligent guys that have been dedicated to try to do the best they could for Tennessee. They've been through some tough times, but quality young men that'll make good citizens.
Some decisions for some of the Tennessee players coming up, though, and we'll talk about that next on Inside Tennessee Football.
Inside Tennessee Football is brought to you by UPS. Logistics helps level the playing field for small businesses. UPS, we love logistics. By Eastman Chemical Company, promoting sustainability. Check us out at facebook.com/goodsports, always recycle. By Yellowwood brand pressure treated pine. If it doesn't have that yellow tag, you don't want it. And by TRH Health Plans, we've got you covered. Get a rate quote online at TRH.com or at your local Farm Bureau office.
Time to announce the AutoZone player of the game. Get in the zone, AutoZone, and in the zone for Tennessee against Kentucky, quarterback Tyler Bray. 20 of 34 through the air, 293 yards and 4 touchdown passes. Congratulations to Tyler Bray, our AutoZone player of the game. For the auto parts, accessories, and advice you need, get in the zone, AutoZone. Back with Tim Priest and Andy Kelly of the Vol Network. Tyler Bray is just one of the juniors on this football team. Andy, tough decision to make. Do you go to the NFL or you come back?
You're right. Several guys are going to have to sit down and think about it, talk to their family, talk to their coaches, and kind of analyze where they think they're going to go in the draft or where they would go. And it's some tough decisions they're going to have to make, the young men, but each individual's different. And, selfishly, from a Tennessee fan, I like to see all those guys back, but certainly understand the ones if they decide to go. I understand that.
Part of it, though, is who's the next coach going to be and how do they fit into that system. So that's another part of the decision. So they really can't evaluate this yet until they know who the new coach is.
It could be. And unless some of the guys have just totally made up their mind that they're going no matter what, some of the guys may wait a while, see what's going to happen here, see who's coming in, as you mentioned, to see what kind of system they think it may be. And if they think eventually it would improve their stock, maybe some of the guys will stay. We'll have to just wait and see.
Yeah, and of course, Jim Chaney will play a role in this because he'll meet with all these juniors to be and try. And I think, you know, Jim's had some experience in the NFL. There's Bill Baker's on the staff's had experience in the NFL, Condridge Holloway in the CFL. They've got enough resources there for those guys to lay this out to them so they can make an intelligent decision.
They do, and Jim Chaney, in not that long ago, was coaching in the NFL. So he's uniquely in a position. And Bill Baker, who was a scout for many, many mm-hmm. years, and they can give him some advice. I'm sure they're going to talk to family, and everybody's got a different situation. But selfishly, I think Tennessee's two starting wide receivers and quarterback could all improve their stock in the NFL, but I'm certainly not qualified to say what round they're going to go in or anything like that, and it's a personal decision for all. I'm somewhat a family decision, I think.
But they will get that information from the NFL, and they'll have a chance to make that evaluation. And a lot of times you need to figure out, do I want to come back? Do I need to come back? And so you hope that they make the best decision for themselves and the family.
You certainly do. And returning to Tennessee, they could be a big help. Tennessee's going to have a really good offensive line, and that's a great place to start building your program. So they should be very good in that position next year. Hopefully they've got a lot of good skill players to go with them.
Yeah, and you would think in the offensive line, Andy, as you know as a quarterback, that's where it all starts, doesn't it?
It starts up front, no doubt about it. Any game you play, and Tennessee's offensive line has matured and grown and become the strength of this team. And you'd expect them to be the strength going into next season with most of the guys coming back, hopefully all of them except for the seniors coming mm-hmm. back, and should be a strong point.
You know, you look at Zach Fulton, you look at Antonio Richardson, James Stone, those are all NFL-type players. They could really be stars with this one more year building up and helping to lead this Tennessee team forward.
Yes, I would be surprised if that entire offensive line's not drafted somewhere in the draft. Mm-hmm. First round, last round, I don't know where, but they're NFL-looking football players, and they've all played a ton in college.
You know, defensively, Andy, you look at Tennessee with A.J. Johnson, who had a spectacular year, leading tackler on the team. He'll wind up one of the top tacklers in the SEC. He's kind of the anchor of that defense, and it's always good to build around a linebacker like that.
Well, it is. He's had some incredible numbers as far as tackles go, and he's been the leader. But a lot of guys are out there. You know, McCullers came on late in the season and started playing really good football. So they've got some guys in there that they're going to get a chance to play at the next level, but certainly came on as the season went on. Had their struggles, you know, for most of the year as a unit, but some great individual effort in there as well.
You know, Tim, it was interesting. We're in the locker room with Coach Chaney after the game, and Daniel McCullers was sitting there getting ready to talk to you, and his first thing to Daniel, get in the weight room as quick as you can.
Yeah.
You need a lot of work.
Well, they're going to lose a defensive back. They're going to lose a linebacker. Everybody else on this defense will return. And so they've got the potential. They get Brian Randolph back, mm-hmm. Get a couple of young defensive backs into the mix. They got a potential to have a much improved defense next time.
Yeah, and Daniel McCullers could be a John Henderson or an Albert Haynesworth with a little more work, too.
I think he's got the potential. I think he showed some signs of what he's capable of doing as the season went on. Definitely a great run stopper. Just, if nothing else, just his body being in there, pushing guys around, making plays. And he's actually developed a little bit of a pass rush. If nothing else, it's a bull rush, getting that center knocked back into the quarterback. That can be very disruptive as well. But he's got a lot of things he's got to work on. But I think the potential is there to be a very good football player.
Tim, Andy, it was good working with you this season. Let's look forward to next year, and let's get some more wins next year.
I'm all for it.
There you go. Me too. Thank
you, Tim Priest and Andy Kelly with us. We'll be back with John Bryce of VolQuest.com in just a moment.
Inside Tennessee Football is brought to you by this season's biggest hit, Volume 2 from the Leader Series, Tennessee Linebackers. On sale now at participating Walgreens and Cracker Barrel Old Country stores or online at volnetwork.tv.
By the Natural Gas Utilities and Pipeline Companies in Tennessee.
Natural gas.
By Hyundai. Loyalty can't be explained, but it explains a lot. Show your loyalty at HyundaiShowYourLoyalty.com. And by the Tennessee Education Lottery. Proud to have raised over $2.4 billion to support education programs in Tennessee. It's time for the First Tennessee First Look, a scouting report and look ahead at the Vols' upcoming opponent. Brought to you by First Tennessee Bank, the official bank of the Vols.
Look at the schedule. It starts with Austin Peay in Western Kentucky, then tough, going to Oregon and Florida, and of course at Alabama, out at Missouri, and then closing the year out Vanderbilt and Kentucky. A daunting schedule there in the middle, especially with that trip to Oregon. John Bryce from VolQuest.com joins us, and Tennessee obviously has a very tough schedule next year, but the first thing, who's going to be coaching the team next year?
Well, yeah, that's going to go a long way in determining exactly how Tennessee attacks that schedule next year and just sort of what expectations are there. It's an interesting schedule. At one point this year, Tennessee was slated next season to travel to the number 1, 2, and 3 teams in the BCS rankings. That's tough for anybody. That's particularly tough for a program in transition. An interesting thing with next year's schedule for Tennessee and for a lot of teams, 2 open dates. That's going to be huge. These kids have been having to play 12-game seasons across just 13 weeks, so 2 open dates is a big break.
You know, there are a lot of people thought that maybe Tennessee wouldn't take that trip to Oregon. Maybe it would go to Nashville or someplace else. Right now, it looks like Tennessee's heading west.
Yeah, I think Tennessee's definitely heading west. I do think, according to some people I've talked to, that Tennessee explored maybe delaying that game or looking at some different options for that game. Oregon, frankly, is having a problem finding teams willing to come out to Eugene and play it. The Ducks have already visited Knoxville, and those games are good for Tennessee. And you know, who knows what the coaching future will be for Oregon's coach. Chip Kelly is a hot commodity. He'll have to turn down the NFL, I would imagine, at some point.
A lot of job openings right now, a lot of things swirling. Tennessee fans, of course, are trying to figure out what's the latest rumor, which is true or not. But I think the only thing that is true is that Dave Hart is running the search, and unless you hear it from Dave Hart, don't really believe it.
Oh, you're absolutely right, Bob. And Dave Hart gained himself a ton of equity on the Sunday afternoon that he addressed the departure of Derek Dooley. And he won over, I think, a lot of respect from people on campus that matter and from people off of campus that matter. And I think Dave Hart's got more control of the athletics program today than ever before.
Yeah, Dave Hart did have that press conference. Here's some of his comments. One of those was talking about what he's selling now to the potential new head coach of the Volunteers.
But we will now move forward in a search process with the goal of securing the best coach we possibly can to come and lead the football program at the University of Tennessee. You've heard me say this before. This is a great place. It's a tremendous place. We have tradition, we have history, we have a brand that is still meaningful. But we have a long way to go to get back to where we want to be. And you can't put all of that on the coach. I don't care if his name is Vince Lombardi or Derek Dooley. We have an obligation as an administration to give our coaches the resources they need, the support they need, intrinsically and extrinsically, to get us back to where we want to be. And so this will be an effort, collective effort, from a lot of people to have us take our rightful place in the Southeastern Conference and beyond.
I thought it was interesting. He outlined several points, and then it was interesting early last week. Chancellor Jimmy Cheek said there'll be some adjustments made.
Yeah, I thought it was extremely telling on Tuesday afternoon when the university publicly released that it was giving $18 million back to the athletic side. And I think that those are items that were outlined Sunday by Dave Hart without ever saying anyone's name or without ever saying exactly what needed to be done. I think the fact that Tennessee so publicly announced the $18 million on Tuesday, that was a message to let everybody know this is a university that's starting to pull together in the same direction on both sides of the aisle. And that was an important, critical step, because I think candidates around the country who are going to be interested in what is a fantastic job here at UT probably saw that and saw it and said, okay, they are getting some things right. They are moving in the right direction.
And it takes some of the financial burden off the athletic department in terms of hiring a coach.
Well, it absolutely takes some burden off of there. There's going to be anywhere from $7 to $9 million involved with the transition out of the Derek Dooley staff, and then you've got to turn around with that much money or more to hire a new staff and place a new staff. And so you've got to have that money up front, and you've got to show people nationwide, especially in this competitive landscape, that the money's there and you're committed to spending it.
And also Dave Hart talked about what he's looking for and the new head coach at the University of Tennessee.
Obviously, we want a coach who knows how to be successful, who's had success, and knows the difficulty of climbing the ladder in the Southeastern Conference and can appreciate and identify with what that takes. We want somebody with integrity. That's important. You know, we just had our probation extended, as you're well aware. We don't have any margin for error. We have to have a culture of compliance that is the number one priority in our athletics department. So, I mean, the profile is one that you would expect it to be. Some of the people will approach. They won't want to engage until their seasons are over. We are not, you know, some people have this false sense that, oh, my gosh, we're late. We're not. I've done this many times, and I can tell you that we're not. We're fine. People need to take a deep breath. You know, we're not, the door's not closing on our opportunities to find the right person.
Comments from Dave Hart. It's interesting, in a week or so, the National Football Foundation has its annual awards banquet, Hall of Fame inductees up in New York, and all the coaches and all the athletic directors will be at the Waldorf Astoria. You can do a lot of interviewing during that time.
You can absolutely do a lot of interviewing during that time, and that event is a who's who of everyone involved with college football, and that's a hotel that's secure enough to sneak presidents in and out. I'm pretty sure they can handle conducting some college football interviews.
It's so interesting. So you think mid-December?
I do think mid-December. I think that time frame is important for Tennessee. I think trying to target someone by around the 10th of December or maybe a few days before gives Tennessee a chance to get some buzz and get some momentum out there before the recruiting dead period. To me, that's a key time for Tennessee. The Vols need to have a coach in place, ideally, before that moment, because you're not going to a bowl game and you need a way to get some of that national limelight.
So the coaching search underway at Tennessee, and we'll be back with more on Inside Tennessee Football in just a moment.
Hey, Vol fans, direct your attention to the video board for today's Loyal Fan of the Game, brought to you by Hyundai. Loyalty can't be explained, but it explains a lot. Think you have what it takes to be Hyundai's loyal fan? Show your loyalty at HyundaiShowYourLoyalty.com.
Back with John Bryce. John, quickly, recruiting now. This staff has to keep everything going for the next couple weeks.
This staff really does need to keep everything going. Jay Graham is a key. I think Sam Pittman is a key. The offensive linemen on the team are keys. They're trying to keep Sam Pittman. They met with Dave Hart to talk about that this week.
Thanks from everybody at the Vol Network for being with us all season long. For John Bryce, I'm Bob Kesling. Thanks for being with us for Inside Tennessee Football.
This has been a presentation of the Vol Network, produced by IMG, the world's premier sports media and entertainment company. For more coverage of this week's game, be sure to watch the Vol Network's two-hour game replay. Check local listings. Produced at the Husker Broadcast Center.